Mission given to me by Woody Shaw, Sunship, Dizzy, and Billy Higgins, dedicated to pursuing a piece of our cultural heritage through interviews with my jazz heroes. This is the Jake Feinberg Show. Welcome, everybody, inside the Blackwood Broadcasting Studios at an undisclosed institute of higher learning. This is the Jake Feinberg Show, and we're happy to have all of you along with us today. The urban legend of Detroit is only for those generations who were not alive during the time when that city epitomized Asphalt Canyon Blues. What we see today in the Motor City is a shell of what it was when my guest today was growing up there. A thriving car industry driven by a migration of blacks from the South after mechanized equipment replaced plantation workers. The combination of family, church, and education brought about a generation of local musicians like no other. Barry Harris, Ron Carter, Tommy Flanagan, Elvin Jones, Donald Byrd, and my guest. My guest's roots are in Detroit, but that was only the beginning of his journey. While at Wayne State, he started recording with the late, great Dizzy Gillespie. This was followed by stints with Oscar Peterson, John Coltrane, Jimmy Smith, and Kenny Dorham. He has recorded as a leader on all the heavy jazz and blues labels like Chess, Cadet, Blue Note, Pretige, Muse, Verve, and Concord. By the early 1970s, on top of his busy playing schedule, my guest started doing college seminars, which included the first regular course held in the U.S. chronicling the music of composer, pianist, and bandleader Duke Ellington. His unpretentious and practical style has helped galvanize knowledge and wisdom for a generation of up-and-coming musicians who did not experience the breakfast sessions at the Jockey Club in Atlantic City, Mean Ole Frisco, or music before idiomatic breakdown. As Duke said, music is either good or bad. Today, my guest is the leader of the Music and Ethnomusicology Department at UCLA. Perseverance, preservation, and whistling while he works. Kenny Burrell, welcome to the Jake Feinberg Show.
Hi, Jake. Happy to be with you.
It's nice to talk to you, man. You know, I wanted my first question. You know, you grew up really at a time when there were no idioms. I talked to Mundell Lowe about this, and he's like, there were no terms. And I'm curious, as it was music, and so how do you talk to your students about developing their own sound? Even though in our current analysis of music, everything must have a label, how do you try to break them out of that?
Well, I just point out to them that the people who have done the breaking through, the people who have become the giants in whatever field they're in, it can be music or it can be other things, literature, law, medicine, etc., regardless of what style that you might place them in, they have an individual uniqueness. And I tell them that everyone is different. I just remind them that everyone is different and everyone is unique in a way. And it's a matter of the individual to bring out their own uniqueness. And part of my job and part of the job of our faculty here is to sense that uniqueness, hear some of it, and try to help them bring it out, point it out to them. In other words, sometimes they don't realize what they have themselves, and that's because they're young.
Mm-hmm.
They're just experimenting and trying different things. But having been around a while and heard a lot of things, we can tell when something is different and something is new and something is unique. So when that happens, we try to point out to them that this is something that's very special to you, and you should work on that and other things like it. So I guess the bottom line is that regardless of what's going on in the business, what labels are floating around, et cetera, it's still up to the individual to bring out the best of who they are and no one else.
You know, it strikes me so interesting, you know, when I talk to different guys, I've interviewed over 300 musicians, Gary Bartz was talking to me about, you know, while he was developing his own sound while learning certain types of music, whereas I tend to think that a lot of younger kids coming into your university and music schools all over the country have learned how to play certain styles of music, but have been less focused on their own individual sound. And I think, is it more of a confidence thing? Like understanding the inside that you have your own voice, just like I'm doing with you right now. I wouldn't have been able to get up here 12 years ago when I got my degree in broadcasting and interview Kenny Burrell. But
right.
but I mean, it's about giving, it's confidence. Is that what it boils down to?
Well, confidence comes in various degrees. I mean, you learn the language by listening to other people that speak the language. In other words, you learn the technique by watching or copying other people who have the technique. But then what have you got to say yourself? And that's the point we try to stress to them that, you've got the technique and you know how to do certain things, you know how to do a lot of things. But then what is your story about? And I think part of what you're saying does have to do with confidence, because you have to have some confidence to have your own voice. In other words, you're asking yourself, is what I have to say good enough? You know, and part of my job as a teacher is to say, yes, it is. You just have to develop it. But you're learning all these things that have been proven and by the giants that have gone before you, and that's been proven to be good. And now you have the technique, and we're never finished with technique. We always improve. But I mean, you have enough technique to start out on your own voyage here, and that takes some confidence. And that's part of my job, to help them understand that they have something, and to help them bolster their confidence.
My first interview was with Pat Martino, and Pat told me a story about him and Charlie Erland in high school. They were 15 years old, and they went to the Jockey Club in Atlantic City, and they saw you and Jimmy Smith. And Charlie Erland at the time was a tenor saxophone player, but that night the output from your band, and especially Jimmy's organ, was just so explosive that he turned on a dime and was immediately started playing the Hammond organ. You know, he didn't know what he was doing. He was playing bass lines and Pat was playing melodies. But the point is, what I'm getting at is, you say it's your job to help the students find their individual voice. But Kenny, what is concerning to me is, and maybe there's something built in Royce Hall or something, but where are the live venues that these kids can, you know, take it outside of the classroom where Bohannon and Burrell are teaching and put it into the live music venues? Because honestly, that's where you get your chops from, right? Am I right or wrong?
Well, that was my school. That was our school. We mentioned Detroit, growing up in Detroit was like going to a jazz university. You know, that's what it was about. So now it's transferred. And the thing is, here, not just at UCLA, but other schools, there's less and less jazz clubs, less and less of what used to be available to musicians trying to learn their way. And it's happening not only in colleges, but in high schools. A lot of your experience as a student now is at the school. And so we have jam sessions here. The kids create their own jam sessions, and they come on Saturdays and different hours, and when they're not having class, and they jam. Okay, we didn't have that opportunity when growing up. We just had to find somebody's house, go to somebody's house, which was cool, was beautiful, or go to, if we were old enough, to go in some club on a Monday night or something, or Sunday afternoon. That's not happening too much. It's happening, but not as much as it used to have happened. So, the experience has shifted from out in the real world, if you will, of the venues that were around now in terms of this music to schools.
Mm-hmm.
Not exclusively, but it certainly has changed. In other words, there's a lot more jazz activity going on in high schools and colleges, and what do you call it, college and high school festivals, jazz festivals, and that kind of stuff, seminars and workshops, than there was before. And there's a lot less activity in the various communities in terms of jam sessions and so forth.
How did you, did you get to see John Lee Hooker live in Detroit? Did you get to see the blues guys play there a lot?
Yeah, the area that I grew up in, it didn't matter. But the point is, there was just local blues players didn't have names, so the names are gone now. But mm-hmm. The point is, that was part of the community. But yeah, occasionally we would hear somebody like John Lee Hooker come through, and then there was an environment where the blues was not separated from jazz, from pop. It was all just music. And then, as you pointed out earlier, the label started to prop up. You know, they had to identify something to sell it, so they had to, that was part of the reason, but it's also part of the problem. It separated things, but it is what it is, and that's the kind of world we live in. But I heard a lot of blues growing up. Part of who I am, you know.
Oh, I mean, when I listened to early, you know, almost all the Kenny Burrell that I have on record, and I mean, there's one album called Earthy that you did. I mean, you can't get much more, you know, down to the core. I guess what I'm leading into is those guys really live the blues in the sense that they didn't, I mean, you could literally see them and they might be blind or they might have no teeth, but yet they're playing and they're singing about their lives. And it's hard to, you know, if you're going to a university now, you know, it's hard to really play jazz or blues if you've kind of lived in suburbia your whole, and that's all I'm saying is I think that.
I understand. Yeah. I understand what you're saying. And you're right. But the point is you're not going to be like other people anyway.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't expect, and in a general sense, people don't expect a jazz artist or a blues artist, just since that's what we're talking about, to sound like somebody else. So you have your own story to tell in terms of blues. And even if you grow up in suburbia, it's still... If you have something to say, it's important. It can be important. Yeah, and so in one sense, you're right. You can't expect youngsters to replicate the sound of John Lee Hooker
mm-hmm.
or others. And some kids try. They learn that. And then, but the point is... The real blues fans are going to say, well, where's your story? Same with jazz.
That's right.
You know, that's what it's basically all about. And thank God for the people, because the business has a tendency to manipulate things where people get confused. But overall, I think people are smarter than we give them credit for.
Well, I think you're absolutely right, and I want to play a track of music for you right now. I'm not sure the last time you heard it, but this is a highlight of mine and really showcases Kenny Burrell's blues playing. So let's take a listen. We'll come back and talk about it.
Thank you.
Well, that mean old Frisco and that lowdown Santa Fe. Baby.
Time you heard that one, but that was Mean Old Frisco from 1963.
That's a long time ago.
And that was with Jimmy Witherspoon on vocals and Leo Wright, and a guy who is still doing beautiful cat. I got a chance to interview Gildo Mahones.
Oh yeah, Gildo, yeah, great musician. That is a perfect example of how these things are intertwined, not really separated in terms of the blues and jazz.
Exactly.
As I said before, that's something that I grew up with, and I feel it's a natural part of who I am.
You look at the track, you were on side A, Jimmy Smith, George Tucker rounded out the rhythm section, but, it's not really rocket science. Listen to the tunes. Mean Old Frisco, Rocks in My Bed, Bad, Bad Whiskey, Baby, 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 Sail On Little Girl, One Scotch, One Bourbon, One Beer. These were rugged times, and you guys were coming in, calloused hands and all, and very earthy, and just playing what you guys were living, and it shines through. And I love the fact that, to be able to talk to musicians who grew up when it was just music, and that's it.
Yeah, I was glad to be part of it, and it's just a beautiful, rich heritage, beautiful, rich history that we have in this country, and that's also part of my mission as a teacher, not just to help the students play better and find their own voice, but also to create an audience that appreciates all of this stuff.
And that's what the goal of my show is to, I'm not a musician, so I'm not going to talk theory, but I'm going to talk about the things we've been talking about, breaking down the idiomatic structure of things, because I think, in my mind, where the word jazz came from, God, there's 900 million different ways of, or different opinions, but I just say, what does it mean to contemporary America? I don't want anybody to have any vision of it. I would just rather call it music.
Right.
If I'm going to open a jazz club in Tucson, or if I'm going to be the artistic director of a jazz club in Tucson, then I'm going to call the club A Love Supreme.
There you go.
Okay, because that connotates Coltrane, and that connotes you're going to brand it through people, the Burrell Club, not jazz. That word has been perverted over time. But I guess coming off of this, it was so nice to hear you playing the rhythm chops and then getting a solo. I just wanted you to talk, because you've had a lot of experience playing improvisational music and then playing with a vocalist. How did you learn to do both?
Well, I think experience, practice experience, and also one of the things that I learned somewhere along the way is to be respectful of the other musicians that you're performing with, and if you're accompanying a vocalist or anybody, but particularly a vocalist as we're talking about now, allow them the room to express themselves and do things that will kind of give them some buoyancy, boost, inspire them in certain various ways that will make them feel good. So in other words, be complimentary, but don't get in the way.
Right.
And that's been my philosophy for many years, and it works pretty well, you know.
Did you know? Going back, you said you'd wind up at somebody's house in Detroit. How quickly did you you link up with guys like Barry Harris and Yusef Lateef? Did you know them when you were just a young boy growing up?
Oh yeah, well. That's two different extremes you just mentioned. It's interesting how you mentioned those two guys, because Yusef is 10 years older than me and Barry is 10 years younger than me. So when I was in high school, which is Miller High School in Detroit, which was very great for me because the music teacher, Mr. Luis Cabrera, knew that I was interested in writing, and so he gave me some great private lessons because he saw my enthusiasm, so much so to the extent where when I went to college and I majored in theory and composition, I didn't have to do any homework in music theory for a couple of years because I was so prepared.
Right.
But prior to my being there, Yusef, whose name was Bill Evans before that, was in that same high school with my brother, Billy Burrell, who was my first teacher on guitar. And they were, like I say, they were there 10 years earlier. And then Barry Harris, who I met later because I was very active and around Detroit, and Tommy Flanagan and I were best friends, and we worked together a lot. And the group coming up behind us, the next generation, was Barry Harris was in that group.
Oh, I see. Okay.
And I was in the group with Donald Byrd and Tommy Flanagan and Pepper Adams and that group, and Elvin, okay.
Wow,
so,
cool.
I was going to say something about, Yusef.
Yes.
Well, Yusef was, I had a really good band at that time, and Yusef was part of my group at one point. So was Pepper Adams, and I remember talking to Yusef because I was at Wayne State at the time, and I convinced him to go, and also encouraged him to start to play the flute, and he did all of that, and then the result is history, and he's now Dr. Lateef, and one of the great musicians of, but I always feel good that I kind of encouraged him to do that, and again, what's significant that he was even an older student going back to school, but it paid off so well for him.
Well, and I mean, you never stop growing. The funny thing is that this is a great story because we keep hearing about austerity amongst our own economics in this country now. And the truth is, back during the war, World War II, if not for austerity, you might have actually played the saxophone, right? I mean, the materials for the guitar were actually cheaper because of the fact that we were in war. So how did that happen?
Right. Well, I was when I was in like 7, 8, 9 years old. I was in really loved music, and my as I say, my brother Billy was playing the guitar, and in my house in Detroit, there was music all around. My mother played a little piano, and my father liked to pick up a ukulele and stuff. But in other words, there was a lot of music in the house. And finally, we got a radio, and I think it was in the Victrola, which was the early record player. But the point was, I was listening to Count Basie and Duke Ellington, and I really loved the saxophone, Herschel Evans and Coleman Hawkins. And plus the fact I was watching my brother play the guitar, and it didn't seem like it was such a big deal to me, you know, because I could play a few chords, and I figured, well, that's no big challenge. So, but it turned out, it was like you say, during the World War II, and my father had passed, and so there was no real money around, and we could not afford a saxophone, so that dream had to go put aside. Then I said, well, I just love music, so I just reluctantly got a guitar.
Right.
Because I wanted to do something. So I just played the guitar, started playing the guitar, and I bought my first guitar for $10 at a pawn shop, and five of which was sent to me by my brother Billy, who was in the Army. So that began the road for me down guitar lane, and then I, at that same time, I heard Charlie Christian, who was playing the guitar like a saxophone anyway, with the amplifier and so forth. So I said, the guitar's not so bad, so I stuck with it, and then I started to hear Oscar Moore, great Oscar Moore with Nat King Cole and others. And all along, the blues was there, you know, just sitting right beside me.
You know, it's yeah, I was going to ask you, my next question was, when you heard the amplified guitar of Charlie Christian, that's when you kind of were like, oh, actually, the guitar actually is quite an impressive instrument, you know?
Right up front line there with the horns and the trumpets and the saxophone with the amplifier. So then I was okay.
So when you got hooked on the guitar, were guys like Donald Byrd, they were still in Detroit? Had they moved, or were you able to?
No, we were all there together. We stayed there until, when I went to college, Donald was still there, and went into our early 20s. There was Flanagan and Donald Byrd, Elvin, I'm trying to think of the people, Paul Chambers.
Oh, my gosh. What a blazing. So, I mean, you guys would get together at somebody's...
Yeah. Well, we had, you know, a little jazz club. We used to have jam sessions every Monday night at this theater, and a small art theater, you know, or actor's theater. But we had sessions, jam sessions at each other's homes, you know, houses, wherever they were. And we'd get a gig every now and then, and we'd play. But jazz was cool, and we would just wanted to play. And it didn't matter who was the leader. As long as whoever got the gig was okay, you know, because we just wanted to play.
Absolutely.
And so that was a... Like I said earlier, that was like a school, because we were learning from each other. We were buying music. We were exchanging music. We were transcribing a lot of stuff off records, because we couldn't buy a lot of the music that's in print today. The students now, they can buy anything. And online, you can get anything. You can get everything online.
Well, I'm gonna challenge you there, because I think that... especially the stuff that we're going to play today, you can't find that online. And I think that you can go... Here's the bottom line. When there was when there was a commerce industry built around music, then all of a sudden you're reading liner notes, you're seeing pictures, and you're listening to the music, and all of a sudden Kenny Burrell comes to life. But now you go onto iTunes, oh, I'm just going to get that 99-cent song because I heard it and I like it a lot. No idea of who the person is, you know, the kind of, you know, I mean, when you read about Kenny Burrell, you pick up on three things: love, humbleness, and humanity. But you don't get that from a digital download. And
you're right. You're absolutely right. Absolutely right.
But I mean, so while there's more, I've heard this from a lot of the guys, you know, there's so much more out there than ever before. But in that case, there's almost too much to choose from, and you're overwhelmed. And so, you know, it's important to go back. And I say to myself, okay, you guys were all somewhat geniuses musically, and you were really active. But if you could, what was so exciting about transcribing and sharing? It was just the idea that you guys felt like you were really creating your own new sound. Is that it?
Well, part of it, we were learning, but the thing is, we were learning more than we realized. When I was talking about you can get anything these days, I'm talking about music itself, the notation.
Right.
You can get any of that is online. That was in books. But what I'm trying to say, growing up in Detroit, there weren't even the books. We had to transcribe the melodies and some of the solos ourselves. And in that process, you really learn and understand what's going on, because you, it takes you time to absorb it and digest what you're transcribing. So you get a theory lesson as you're doing it. You get a lesson in harmony and melody as you're doing this, and you also understand kind of what that musician was thinking about. But now, as you say, there's so much available that it's almost like they don't know what to choose. So that's another part of my mission, our mission, is to help them understand what is important in terms of the jazz repertoire, you know. And so that's part of what I do in terms of guiding them to learn certain songs. I mean, there's thousands of songs that they can get immediately by just pushing a few buttons. And
you know, I just wanted to say, you know, it's what it just comes to me right now is this idea of it's the there's so much music, but at the same time, one of the most exhilarating things is to identify the people as well, because
right.
You know, you are a living example of that. We just R.I.P. Donald Byrd. We just lost him, and
yeah.
You know, but there were guys like Donald Byrd who were leaders at Howard University who would take their young students. This is how flexible it was back then. But I mean, he was able to take his students and take them on the road.
And
that is, that's like, wow. You know, I tend to think like, you know, that to me is real time learning. And I don't know if we'll ever get back to that ever, but that to me is one of those historical things. I think one of the reasons why people don't know what to choose is because they don't know their history.
That's right.
You know,
you're right.
But we got another track of music here. Again, fashioning a unique part of Kenny Burrell's repertoire. Let's take a listen and come back.
Okay.
I'm going to go out on a limb and say that was you whistling.
Yeah, that was. Yeah.
For those, that was from an album, Kenny Burrell album, Asphalt Canyon Suite. And I've noticed recently, wow, that's a whole new sound. I mean, where did that whistling come in? How long were you doing that from when you were a boy?
Oh, everybody whistles. I think.
No, but I mean, to have the guts to put it on an album is different, though.
Well, it just seemed to be appropriate because one of the things that I don't know if you've ever been to New York.
I grew up in New York.
Okay, then you understand when the streets are not busy,
mm-hmm.
and you're walking down one of those streets in New York with all the buildings on the side, if you whistle, you get an immediate sound, a special sound in New York, like no other place. It has a reverberation, and that kind of was kind of what made me do that. Because it's the Asphalt Canyon, which is dedicated to New York.
Right. And well, then it's very, you know, the album is, I was curious because it says asphalt. So I'm like, okay, that's clearly the connotation of a city.
Right.
But then the canyon, is that just the echoes, the reverberation of the whistle? Or
to me, it's, it's kind of like that's what Manhattan itself
mm-hmm.
kind of represented to me.
that's cool, man. I'm going to have to do that because I've spent many nights at, you know, going home at 3 or 4 in the morning, not necessarily sober, but I got to next time whistle and hear that reverberation. That's pretty cool.
You can hear people doing it. You can be in your apartment and hear people in the street doing it. And I think that might be where I got that from. But the point is, it's a kind of an image of that city.
You know, as best you can, that was part B of Asphalt Canyon Blues. And, you know, was that spontaneous, or was that something that you had thought about going into the session? I mean, were you just, you did a long solo before that, then it was whistling, then you go back to a solo.
I don't know. I don't remember how I came up with that, but I'm just guessing now that, or trying to remember, rather, that that was the reason I wanted to put that sound in there,
mm-hmm.
to kind of connect with the city itself and not leave jazz, but just kind of put a sound in there that would be more directly associated with the real life of what's going on in the streets there.
There's no listing of the accompanist, but I noticed an album earlier. I think it's called Soul Call. I'm not exactly sure. You're the leader
right.
on it.
Yeah.
And I wanted you to spend some time just talking about a total unsung hero. He's left us now, but a conguero that from a Latin conguero who was always the first call jazz guy was Ray Barreto. And can you talk about what Ray was like? You know, I was born in 78. I mean, Ray, I never saw him, but I know that he used to go to schools, and he was just, he was a rocker, and I wanted to ask you about him.
Well, Ray was, first of all, he was a great musician, and one of the most flexible musicians I ever met in terms of Latin percussion. And somehow he got connected with the jazz labels like Prestige or Savoy, I forget which one he was recording with the most. That's how I met him at probably one of those sessions. And then, you know, through the years, recorded more with him, became friends with him. And then toward the end of his life, we did some recordings together just with his band and me as a special guest. I don't know if you're aware of those. Duke Ellington, Clave, that was one of them.
Wow.
And in fact, that was a very nice record. It was Duke Ellington, Clave, Ray Barreto, and I was a special guest. But the thing about Ray was that he knew how to put that spice, that Latin spice to the flavor into the rhythm. And it still was not disturbing what we were doing in terms of jazz concept, but it added a certain nice touch, as Juan Tizo would say, a Latin tinge. But I think it was more than a Latin tinge. It was it added an extra flavor to what we were doing, and he knew exactly, again, how to accompany, to add, to support, and not get in the way, and he was perfect for that.
Did you have a chance to go to the Palladium to see those guys play the Africa?
Couple of couple of times, yeah. Yeah, when I lived in New York, yeah.
And one more thing, I'm glad I played the whistling track, the Asphalt Canyon, but you got to tell, there's a track on here that said, Going to Jim and Andy's. What was Jim and Andy's about?
Jim and Andy's was a bar restaurant that all of the guys used to hang out in. I think it was, let me just think, it was around 54th Street between Broadway and 8th. Hmm. It was a bar where a lot of the studio musicians would hang out, especially guys who were busy in the studios, and the jazz guys as well. But this mainly the studio guys. But a lot of those were jazz musicians as well. And then Jim and Andy's was also on 48th Street for a while. Near 6th Avenue, and then they moved up to 54th. I think it was 54th Street. It was on 48th Street near 6th Avenue. And it was just a nice place where they had great food, and you'd see all your friends in there, different musicians. And especially if you were a guy who was busy in the studios where you had to do two, maybe three record dates a day, that would be a nice place to just go and relax and have some food and hang out with the other musicians. So that was kind of just what that was, Jim and Andy's.
Yeah, absolutely. No, I only say that because it has a real funky blues kind of thing. So I said, Kenny must have been there, having some Stromboli with a Scotch or something like that.
Right. You know? Well, all of that, and on various days, they had a great menu, and it was cool, and a good place, good memories from that place.
Do you have a recollection, like, when you, it seems to me that when you first got in, started recording, especially on your own albums for Verve, there was those labels had a very much a direct motto of saying, well, these albums might not give us may not be $1 million sellers, but it's what we stand for. This is the music that we stand for, and therefore the artists like yourself had a lot more creative input. And I'm curious. I mean, someone like yourself, you probably have always had that ability to get your two cents in there. But did you notice at any point where, a lot of that creative input from the musician was taken away? Was there a year or a certain point where you just said, wow, this is, these guys are playing and they're not really even playing what they want to play?
Well, yeah, that happens. That has happened through the years. I was, as you say, I was very fortunate that I was able to pretty much do what I was okay with in terms of the plans for recording. I never had too much objection about it, maybe one or two occasions, but for the most part it's been very, very satisfying, and even the times when I don't want to go into that today, but even when it was not the best of situations, it turned out okay. It just wasn't ideal for what I had in mind. But for the most part, I'd say well over 95% of the time, I was okay with how things went.
Mm-hmm.
But again, you have to, how can I say this? I'll put it another way. If you don't speak up for what you believe in, oftentimes you're not going to get it. and I had several times when I had to really speak up, sometimes in very strong terms and sometimes very diplomatically. But that's the way it is, because different people have different priorities. A musician has one, an A&R person or company executive may have another one.
Exactly.
And so, if they have a disagreement, then it's got to be solved. But my thing is, I've always remembered that my name is going to be on the record, not this person I'm having a problem with. They're thinking about their job, maybe about if they don't produce a certain amount of sales or whatever, they're going to lose their job. Whatever, without getting into too much detail here, to me, it's worth fighting for, because your reputation's on the line when you make a recording. And I've always remembered that. So I've tried to make sure that I did what I believed in. And I feel I've been very, very fortunate.
Yeah, no, I was going to say, because the A&R guy is intent on, well, we need to make a hit.
Not all of them.
That's right, exactly.
Even in an artistic judgment, there could be some problems, and you have to, the bottom line is whose name's on this record.
That's
and,
right.
What are the people going to think when they hear the record? They're not going to blame the A&R guy. They're going to blame the person whose their name they're buying this record from.
Well, and whether they can do it, the people in their private lives can do whatever they want, but the point is that Kenny Burrell has to live with that for the
right.
rest. You want to make sure that your imprint is on that, and that's a beautiful thing. We're going to play one more track of music. This is an earful test for you, Mr. Burrell, and this is really Jake Feinberg's pocket for Kenny Burrell, so let's take a listen. We'll come back.
Okay.
What that song was?
I don't remember now.
we have Up the Street, Round the Corner, Down the Block.
All right.
1974 Kenny Burrell, Fantasy Records. Actually a song written by Alan Gums.
Right. Up the street.
And there's a cat on here that I need you to expand on, because he's one of the most beautiful players. I've heard him with Cal Jader. I hear him with you a lot. And I'm not sure if he has left us yet or not, but it's Richard Wyans.
Oh yeah, he's still around in New York.
You got to link me up with that guy, because you put him on here, and him and Jerome Richardson, Andy Simpkins, Lenny McBrown, and Mayuto Correa,
right.
Unbelievable. I mean, really, and that's when how long did you live in San Francisco for?
I didn't.
You did.
So I used to go there a lot. That's all. I signed with Fantasy Records. I lived in L.A. when I was doing that, I believe. And I would just go up there and record. I had a contract with them. I was doing like maybe a couple of records a year.
Right. Yeah. And that was really in the early '70s. And again,
yeah, I was living in Los Angeles.
And because I was going to say, there's songs on here like Sausalito Nights. I mean, clearly, one thing that was going on at a certain time pre-internet was pre-computer, really, was this idea of these regional hotbeds of music. You had them in Detroit, you had them in Indianapolis, you had them in San Francisco, and so on. Did you ever get to a point where, or did you ever walk into a city anywhere where you were kind of just floored by the regionalism of the music that you weren't aware of at the time?
Not in the United States, no.
Never. So not...
In other parts of the world, yes. But I think it was about a month, maybe a month, maybe 6 weeks in Sausalito. I was working in a club nearby, and I stayed there for that little time. That's when I wrote that song, Sausalito Nights.
What club was it?
I can't even remember the name of it now. It's no longer there, but it was on in Sausalito.
Okay, I'm gonna have to. Yeah. I'll probably have to get. And who were you playing with? You had a residency there.
I just was I was there for like a summer 6 week gig. I forget who. Probably was Lenny McBrown, and I forget who else. Maybe guys who lived in the area. You know.
You said something that caught my attention. Not in the States. Where in the world did you go that floored you when you heard that certain music that you were never exposed to?
Oh, all over, in Japan, in France, in Brazil, every you know, different places I've been. It's incredible, you know.
The my final question for you, just if you would, you've probably been asked this before, but just wanted to spend a little time talking about your relationships with two of your peers. One was Grant Green, and the other was hard scrabble blue collar guitar player from Indianapolis, Wes Montgomery. You know, to me, the three of you were Midwest linked inseparably, but I know the other guys succumbed to their own things, but they were what made them, and throw Coltrane in there as well.
Right.
What, you know, what were those intangible things that made them so special?
Well, I think there is a unwritten understanding. There's a credo kind of among in jazz, because the, you know, the essence of jazz is improvisation. So the thing is that we've been talking earlier, be who you are. And so each one of these guys that you just mentioned, Grant Green, Wes Montgomery, and John Coltrane, they had their own unique individual voices. And I had the great fortune of playing with all of them. And Grant and I became friends. You know, certainly I was older than him, but when he came to New York, we became friends, and we used to have little friendly battles around, you know, guitar. And I've liked him very much as a person, and I loved his music. And unfortunately... He had some problems, and mm-hmm. the fact that the business in so many ways is not kind to musicians, jazz musicians in particular, didn't help anything. So I feel really bad that here was another victim of these circumstances. But this is great American music, and the musicians are not treated as great American musicians. And so part of my mission in terms of what I'm doing now and will be doing in the future is to try to help correct that idea, to try to gain more respect for the music and the musicians. That will help not only recognize and accept the past, but also have a better future for what's going on.
Well, I'll tell you, Mr. Burrell, I have hundreds of hours of interviews, and if I would love to become some kind of partner, because I think that the story you just told there about Grant and other stories about guys like that passed way too early and that weren't treated well. It's beyond the music. It's I have it's all primary source, my friend, and I can't thank you enough for today, and I hope we can collaborate in the future because I think I have some stuff that would be very useful.
Well, that sounds really good to me. I'd love to take you up on that, Jake. I think you're doing a great job, and I appreciate your interview today, and I like the way you're doing this, and I like your broad perspective on this whole matter.
Thank you, Mr. Burrell, and we'll be in touch. When I get out to L.A., we'll try to link up for a cup of coffee.
Great.
All right, now. Thank you, sir.
All right, you're welcome.
Take it easy.
Right, bye-bye.
Bye-bye. This is the Jake Feinberg Show. We'll see you all in a little bit.